All right, welcome to Combat Radio. I'm Ethan Dettenmeyer here in Los Angeles, and from some undisclosed secret sort of lair of all things scientific and awesome is writer, well, all around general talent, Ed Naha. Ed, how are you, buddy?
Thank you.
And I mean, all of you, first of all, let me just state for the record for the people listening, you've been sort of our de facto clandestine political analyst on Facebook for a long time. You probably don't even know that, but I get all my political news and outlook from you. Your posts are hilarious. But you've also written for everything from Starlog to Fangoria to Rolling Stone. You did Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. You got that ball rolling. And you also wrote, and if I can, I just start with the Making of Dune book that you did? Is that, now Dune, I mean, that's an, Dune is a very, very interesting part of Hollywood folklore, right? Wouldn't you say?
Oh, it was amazing. The script was about the size of the white pages of a phone book. And it was just from the outset looking at it, you know, as an outsider, because I was hired by Universal to do this book. As an outsider, I just looked at it and just went, how the heck are you going to do this? And everything that could go wrong did.
Well, to start with, you know, my opinion on Dune gets a lot of flack and artillery fire and all. I did not love the book, although I saw the merits in it. I know that's like the scientific gospel to a lot of people. It's just my opinion. But however, when I saw the film first, went back and read the book, and actually I had a lot more sort of admiration for the way Lynch put the book into screenplay form. I know because of how the movie ultimately did that saying that draws fire, but I thought he actually organized it in a way, you know, putting the box of pain behind the Navigator's Shakespearean plot and kind of the way he restructured it for a movie audience was actually pretty good. I mean, this is one of the all-time Hollywood misfires to me because I remember as a kid seeing the trailer and being like, holy fuck, they got Sting in this movie. And they baited all of us. And it looked great. The trailer looked great for the time. I mean, there was S.H.I.E.L.D. fighting. The costumes and the sets were totally out of this world. Unbelievably well done. And so I bought in. And then, of course, I see the movie and I'm like, what happened? I took a nap. I fell asleep right around, you know, such and such. But why did Universal hire you to do the book? Because they liked your skill set or because you're a fan of the project? Or how does Ed Naha get mixed up in this?
Oh, serendipity.
And do you like it? Do you like the movie?
No. But it was really, the odds were stacked against it. They filmed in Cherubusco Studios in Mexico. And just having a steady source of electricity was a challenge down there. And when you're doing it, like initially they had hired, oh, let me go back. So anyhow, prior to my being hired, I had done a couple of novelizations. The one that caught their eye was RoboCop. I did the two RoboCop novelizations, and the lady from merchandising called me up and said, would you be interested in doing this? And I said, sure. And everything that could go wrong did go wrong. It was incredibly expensive. Initially, they had hired John Dykstra, who was coming off Star Wars, to do the computer animation. In terms of the spaceships and things like that. And they didn't have, because of the electrical problems, they couldn't do that. So they had to part ways with John. They hired new folks to come in and actually constructed spaceships, little tiny model guys, you know, and they, for the sand, they used little pieces of glass, little glass balls, and which people were inhaling. You know, safety wasn't a primary directive on this movie, and some of it was great. I saw this one scene where there was a lot of improvising as much as you could. And so you had David directing. His AD spoke Spanish, so he would speak to the extras. And the extra things were iffy, the extra reactions. So this one scene, there was supposed to be an explosion. And all the extras were huddled, you know, and they had been taught, the AD was Cookie, and Cookie would fire a gun, a blank gun, to show them when they were supposed to, you know, duck. And what happened was, it wasn't going well. So David had explosives drilled into the walls. It was like a cavern, and didn't tell the extras.
Yeah.
So at a certain point, I see all the Anglos on the crew backing away.
Right.
And this one guy says to me, "Get back over here." These guys, the extras nearly pissed themselves because there was an actual explosion with a lot of crap just flying through the air, and it made for a great scene, but you know, somebody could have got hurt.
You think Ed? Like, who's the safety officer on this goddamn production is my question. We're gonna drill explosions into the walls, and look, whatever happens, happens, Lynch.
I think it was the angry God of the Old Testament who was just basically taking safety standards into his own hands.
Right.
They burned tires for smoke.
Yeah, right, which probably gave you a lifetime worth of breathing issues.
Yeah. So it was sort of like guerrilla filmmaking with this mega budget. And then you had Dino De Laurentiis at that time had an Italian restaurant. He opened line of Italian bistros, I believe. Anyhow, he created this state-of-the-art, like hoity-toity restaurant there for everyone to, you know, to be able to hang out in and eat pasta. And everything got held up in customs. So you would have a camera missing, you would have lenses missing, and about 100 pounds of pasta.
Well, the first thing you need when you go into production in Mexico is you need to make sure you're bribing the right customs officials. That's rule. I mean, even the lowest executive in feature development knows that moving forward. I love the idea of people snorting glass or breathing in glass, and depending on, you know, the effects of said glass, maybe the movie's easier to work on. I don't know. It's like, what's remarkable about everything you're saying about missing parts and David Lynn trying to keep a grip on this is that the movie doesn't seem to reflect this level of chaos. The movie really kind of comes across in a very, to me anyway, a pretty tranquil movie. I mean, look, let's back up and let's kind of take this movie apart for a minute, because I got to tell you, I don't have a lot of Dune aficionados who can open up the archives on this movie, so this is kind of a rarity for me. Was Lynch the first director for the movie?
I don't know. In terms of Dino and Universal, I believe so. I think they were very impressed with. I could be taking this chronologically out of order, but I think they were very impressed with The Elephant Man.
Well,
and I think, but they were totally unaware of Eraserhead. So they saw one aspect of David without really paying attention to the others. So in terms of design, in terms of really the visuals of the movie were striking. There's nothing subtle about them, but they were just, in terms of just standing in front of these things, and they were built to scale. I mean, they were just huge projects. And the one of the fellas who worked on the animatronics was, oh golly, he later did E.T.
Ribaldi.
Yeah. And who I got to know a little bit later on. But it was nuts. I mean, people would be laying cables and just hope that the cables worked. You know, it was just like,
Well, McLachlan said the idea was like a three-picture deal. It was going to be Universal's sort of Star Wars equivalent, not in terms of tone, but in terms of what it could do in terms of box office sci-fi, right? That's what McLachlan said. And it's interesting, like, I get in arguments with director Steve Sergic constantly about Eraserhead. And before I get a Twitter war going with this, I have a lot of respect for Lynch, but I cannot get my head around Eraserhead. I look at that movie and go like, what the fuck did this guy do? You know, and people love that movie and they will argue with me about it constantly. I actually have more respect for how Lynch organized the Dune book into a screenplay. I just don't get Eraserhead, although I do have, like I said, respect for the guy. But I don't understand why you go into this thing and you don't, like, look, let's simplify it. All right, it has a fantastic cast. It has beautiful production design. Like you just said, you can look at the movie and be in awe of the sets and the costumes. And then when people start talking, you tune out. And that's because every character has, like, an inner monologue. And it's not necessarily an inner monologue that's significant. I mean, even the maid is like, perhaps I should change his sheets now. It's like Linda Hunt, you got an Academy Award winner for The Year of Living Dangerously. And she's like, yes, maybe I'm the step and fetch it to somebody significant. It's like, you don't need all these inner monologues. I just like
Kwan. That was the title. Her name was Billy Kwan in that movie.
Yeah. It's a brilliant movie and a brilliant performance. And if you haven't seen it, watch The Year of Living Dangerously. I just don't know, and this isn't my experience at Warner Brothers Feature Development talking, but I don't know why you don't simplify it. Like, look, if you know the worms are going to be a challenge, the things you've got to get right in a movie like this, if you've got the story, which they had, is the battle scenes and the effects, right? Because it takes you right out of the movie if this turns into a Harryhausen flick. So, with all due respect to Harryhausen. So, you can't have Clash of the Titans on Arrakis, right? So, if you can't master the worms, which I heard was a problem, why don't you just cut them out and go full Jaws? Like these things, these sand crawlers just get pulled under. Like, why do you have to do the whole thing where you have to rely on the worms to deliver the final attack? And it's like, I don't understand why people just didn't think, like, cut this, change this, let's streamline this. It just seems so long and drawn out, and they crutched on elements that I don't think they ever got right.
Well, the deal is with, I think there was a lack of experience and just across the boards in doing a project this big. Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone really took into account the difficulty that they were going to have. I'm sure, you know, shooting at Churubusco was a cost-cutting aspect of the film. But once you get down there, once you're committed to cost-cutting like that, that becomes your driving wheel.
Right.
That becomes your engine. And what I found was trying to, like, just from a journalist's point of view, it was like herding cats. There was so much going on at the same time. You know, they weren't aware of what they were biting off. You know, the fact that one of the major concerns on a day-to-day basis was the pasta kind of, you know, shows you what was going on. But everyone was great. I mean, I love Dino. I just loved Dino. And Raffaella his daughter was wonderful. And they had this really great sense of humor, because, you know, you'd be doing something and all of a sudden, they were shooting this one scene, it was a battle scene. And they found a place that was near the studios. And what they were gonna do is dig it up and then make it into a battle scene. Well, it turns out that it was the local village's dead dog dump.
Oh.
So nice. This is where all the stray...
Use it. Yeah.
Well, the thing is, yeah, they had to dig out all these dog carcasses, and then they had this little girl. She must have been five, walking through this. You know, there's smoke, and there's fire, and there's blah, 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 blah. And this little girl is there, and it's just like, it's the most toxic environment that you can imagine. It was phenomenal. And there was a certain sense of almost gallows humor to it. And plus, because a lot of the cast was young, and there were mind-altering substances down there that added to the difficulty. And it was wild.
By mind-altering substances, what exactly are you saying, Ed Naha?
A lot of NyQuil.
Yeah. Right.
People were smoking their NyQuil.
Now, did you enjoy doing this project? Were you like a fan of the book, or was this an ideal assignment for you, or were you just covering this with sort of a journalist mindset of, let me document what's happening here?
Well, I did. I was a fan of the all the books, actually. I didn't see how they were going to pull this off, but I thought, you know, it's a gig.
Right. I
mean, I've taken so many weird gigs over the course of my lifetime. I was William Shatner's publicist for a while.
I want to talk about that next. Hold that thought. Keep going.
Okay. But it was a gig. And, you know, when you're a freelancer, you take gigs. And so when I was down there, I just thought, oh my goodness. I mean, this is, I've arrived. I'm working for a major studio.
Yeah.
And look at all these nifty people. And there were some people down there who were great. There was an actor named Paul L. Smith. And he played Bluto in Robin Williams, the Altman Popeye film.
Another legendary production. We're naming all the hits today, buddy.
Well, the thing is, he was huge. Yeah. I mean, he was just this big, barrel-chested man. And they had those suits were heavy that they wore. He lost like 75 pounds during the course of the filming, just from walking in the sand. It was, but he was great, you know, and Kyle was great.
You could tell the cast delivered because nothing about that shoot seems easy. I mean, Mexico, wherever you find the desert, to wear those kind of costumes and to do all the physicality that comes with a battle scene, not fun. Smith is great in the movie. He's since passed away and he told some great stories about eating like dead cow's tongue and whatever, you know. All the stuff he had to do for Lynch, total team player. You know, he was in Midnight Express.
Yeah. Oh, was he ever?
Yeah. I mean, total legendary actor in terms of a guy that you think you can give any sort of disgusting job or role to. And he is like almost thrives in it. You know, he's so good as the Beast in that movie. You know, and I think Batista's got the role this time around, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not totally up to speed on the new production, but... But, you know, I have a lot of respect for all these players. I mean, the producers are still based at Universal, where we broadcast from. And I've been, you know, De Laurentiis, Rafaela, obviously, you know, was producing, like, I think three movies at the time. The Conan sequel, Dune, and a third one. And it's just, I mean, I love the cast. I love the crew. I'm just like, what the fuck happens here? It just looks like something that tried to be, and maybe I should salute them for this instead of criticize them, that they tried to be so ambitious that if they would have scaled it back, they probably would have had a much more, because all the Shakespearean elements are there, right? So they would have had a probably a much more effective story to tell.
Well, I think the part of the problem is, had this been made during a different era, you probably could have gotten a 3-hour film with an intermission, like, you know, the mill films in the 50s and stuff. But at that point in the 80s, we were sort of getting into short attention span theater.
Right.
You know, it's like, who, over the last few decades, comedies should be 90 minutes. If they're 2 hours, well, they're criticized for being too long for a comedy. This could have easily have been, you know, an afternoon experience where you go to, or an evening experience. You go and see an hour and a half, you have your little, you know, let's go out to the lobby. And then you come back for the conclusion of Dune. But, you know.
It's now the exciting conclusion of Dune.
Yes.
Well, though, there's moments, you make a very interesting point, because times were changing. And you would think David Lynch, as intelligent as he is, would have been in tune with that. And at some point, someone has to look at the script and say, light it up there, light it up there, light it up there, and keep the audience involved. Don't go down this rabbit hole of too much prophecy and inner monologue and we will wait and see if he is the one that we are. It's like, no. You know, go for the weapons, go for the weapons, go for the weapons. And that's just the you know, I think the delivery system of today's cinema. You know, they remade it for the Sci-Fi Channel and it looked like a fucking Versace's closet exploded on a set. I mean, it's like, I watched that and I'm like, what the fuck did these guys do? Because if I do think they got one thing right on the movie, it was brilliant sound design. If you listen to the sound design on that movie, it's like enthralling. You know, the way the machinery is working in certain scenes, like they're in a dungeon, and beautiful sets, beautiful cast, beautiful costumes. I think in short, I was just rooting for the movie to be more than it was.